fantastic. Brilliant. Thank you very much, Susanna, and great to see you all. And a massive thank you to the Minister for a brilliant presentation. I should say, I love the boring stuff, so that's manna to my... It's wonderful to hear that. And he could not, I think, have set me and the two speakers up better, even if he'd actually used the speech that the team had written for him with what he said today. I said yesterday that it was day 41, so today is obviously day 42. I'm not quite sure how this morning's going to go, but I have worked out if I get to day 44 on Sunday, or 45 on Sunday, I will have outlasted the lettuce and done longer than Liz trusted. So we'll see how it goes this morning. I'll always have that. These conferences, as we said yesterday, are a fantastic opportunity for us to meet, to get together, to swap ideas and to swap stories, exactly as we did last night. For those of us who are chiefs, it gives us an opportunity to learn more about each other and to develop a kind of deeper understanding and deeper relationships. And so, for example, here's a picture of Caitlin, my wife, and I, and me on holiday in Athens. Now, what you need to know about Caitlin, and you'll meet her at RIAT, is that she is, in fact, a divorce lawyer. So if she gives you her card, you just need to be careful. If she gives your spouse her card, you need to be really careful. But Athens is 3.5 hours flying time away from London. It's the same distance as it is to Kyiv. I find it incredible that in the 21st century, there has been a war going on in Europe for more than 500 days that's killed tens of thousands of people. That war is showing us some of the threats that we are going to have to face in the future. And it's giving us an insight into the future character of conflict. Now, I'm conscious we've talked a lot about Ukraine over the last day and a half. But we actually do live in a world that is already more unstable and more dangerous than it has been for some time. Our Prime Minister, Rishi Sunak, said the world is defined by danger, disorder, and division. But it's what he said next that is more important for us in the room today. We need to out-cooperate and out-compete our adversaries if we're going to do our job, which is to protect our people, our countries, and our interests around the world. And that seems to me to be the real purpose for these kind of conferences, to share ideas, develop thinking so that we're able to do our job. But that starts with us understanding what the threats are that we face, and those threats are changing. For the last 25 years, we have enjoyed air supremacy in pretty much every operation we've been part of. We've concentrated our forces in smaller numbers of large bases. This is Kandahar. At its peak, they had over 400 aircraft based there permanently and more than 29,000 people. We did that because it was efficient, and the greatest threat we faced was from indirect fire or insurgents. But we know from what we've seen in Ukraine the threats that are going to face our air forces and our air bases, from long-range aviation, cruise missiles, massed drone attacks. We also know the story of the first few days of the war in Ukraine. It started with cyber attacks trying to write down Ukraine's networks. The military operation began at A500 local with more than 100 standoff missiles fired from land, sea and air at our air defences, our air bases, command and control and sites in Odessa. And to give you a sense of the scale for a country like ours in the United Kingdom, the distance from Kherson to Kyiv is about the same distance as it is from London to Newcastle. Now, we've got to be careful drawing too many conclusions from the war in Ukraine, even after 500 days. But there is one conclusion I think we can safely draw, and we heard it yesterday, is that we do not want to fight like that. The scenes from the front line are reminiscent of the First World War. Serhii Pocky, in his recent book, described it as a 20th century war fought with 19th century war fought with 20th century tactics and 21st century weaponry. The fact is that neither side, as the minister described, has been able to gain air superiority. They were locked in a struggle between offence and defence, where the advantage is with defence. An offence faces a massive challenge without air superiority and without being able to strike the adversary in the deep. Now, some will argue that Russia is now weaker than it was before it started the war. And that is certainly true in the land domain. The army has lost more than two-thirds of its tanks. But the Air Force remains largely intact. Now, we've been thinking hard in the UK about how we deal with these threats. And fundamentally, as we heard yesterday, what we have to do is deter our adversaries from using military force against us. And using the doctrine of the four C's around deterrence, we need to understand what we need to communicate so that our adversaries comprehend that we have a credible capability, that we're ready to fly and fight, and that they will lose. And we pulled this thinking together into the air operating concept. And I want to share that with you today because we need to work on this together as air forces. One of our great strengths in the West is our ability to challenge, to learn from our mistakes, and to develop our thinking and get better. Now, in British doctrine, a concept is simply an idea about how to fight and win. It's not the answer. It allows us to understand the problems, to define them, and test and identify solutions. If we get it right, it provides this brilliant headmark from which all of our rest of our thinking around capability planning, around training, around education can fit. I'm sure that our air operating concept won't be right, but I think it's good enough to provide a foundation for a discussion and to develop that thinking with our allies. And as I say, if we get it right, it will provide that headmark from which everything else will flow. At its heart is a fundamental point that the Air Force's principal role is to gain control of the air. In the future, that control of the air might be limited in time and geography. But without control of the air, you cannot strike at the adversary. You can't do it from the air or from the land or from sea. And whilst we talk a lot and we've drawn a lot on the lessons we've seen from Ukraine, the operational challenges our air forces will face wherever we're fighting are going to be the same. We're going to have to break into our integrated air and missile defences of our adversaries. We're going to face cruise missile attacks and long-range missile attacks on our air bases and our air forces. And we're going to face hybrid attacks on our logistics chains and our industrial base. All of us are going to face those threats. Now, we talk rather grandly in our air operating concept about our theory of winning. And that's based around the fundamental principle of decision superiority. And that comes from the teaching of John Boyd. Now, despite his phenomenal contribution to military thinking and air power thinking, it turns out he was a pretty difficult bloke to live with and work with. He was described as loud, abusive, and profane. Robert Coram, who wrote his 2002 biography, described him like that, also said that like most fighter pilots, and Greg Bagel, wherever you are, this is for you, mate. Like most fighter pilots, he took a certain pleasure in his profanity, crudeness, and coarseness of his sense of humour. Now, it's difficult for us to know actually a lot about what Boyd thought, because he wrote almost none of it down. What he did, though, write was a presentation. It was about 200 slides long called The Pattern of Conflict. And you can actually go and find it on the brilliant Colonel John Boyd website. And what he was interested in were battles where numerically superior forces lost to weaker, smaller forces. And the pattern he found that in those conflicts, what you didn't see was force on force, head to head. What those smaller forces did, they used deception, they used speed, fluidity of action, and they applied strength against weakness. And through that, that disorientated, confused the adversary. And in the end, it in Boyd's words, tactics that unraveled the enemy. And that's at the heart of our thinking. Central to his ideas was this idea, it was this concept of a two-way relationship between the observed and the environment, the observer and the observed. And what he found was that if the environment could change faster than the observer could cope with, that led to disorientation and confusion. One of his most famous and probably least understood legacy is the OODA loop, which tries to capture it. It's often taught as this simple one-dimensional cycle. That's how I was taught it at Staff College. But the reality is, it's much more profound and much more sophisticated than that, as his original sketch demonstrates. The key to it is to get inside the mind and decision cycle of your adversary, and through that, to disorientate him, confuse him, and ultimately lead him to unravel. So alongside the concept of decision superiority, which is fundamentally for us about faster, better decisions, which is as much about education and training as it is about technology or improved C2, are three other supporting concepts. One is about agility, resilience, and integrated action. Now, we talked a lot yesterday about agile combat employment. I think Jonas said we're not entirely all on the same page. I'm not sure even in the Air Force we're on the same page. For me, agility is about speed of movement. If we get it right, then it helps us survive. It helps us with our resilience and will actually help us deliver decision superiority. And whilst it might be difficult to necessarily know how to describe it, I think we've got a pretty good idea when we see it that that's what it is. Love that. Going to be forever known as Ninja Cats, apparently, in the future of this. Integrated action that sits alongside it, we know will deliver operational advantage. We've already seen it across the air operating centres in the Middle East, where we integrate air, space and cyberspace. It delivers a force multiplying effect. But imagine the impact you could have if we did that across all five domains and we could do it on a multinational basis. The opportunity it would have to probe and test and disorientate and confuse our adversaries would be remarkable. Now, I'm not naive. I know that this is not easy to do even as a single nation. But we've got to try to do it together because it's through that integrated action, that we will really be able to confuse and outmaneuver our adversaries. Now, the final thing I want to talk to you about is an issue that came up yesterday to do with process and structures. And fundamentally, I think we need to rethink the balance between how we deliver, the risk to delivering our operational imperatives and the actual risk to operating. We've seen in our friends in Ukraine and Israel how they've been able to adapt incredibly quickly to changing circumstances. I'm not sure all of us as Air Forces quite match up to that. Over 40 years, we have mercifully, as Air Forces, become much safer. But I wonder, in the kind of future character of conflict that we face, whether we need to think differently about how we understand and take risk. And I want to illustrate this and the change over that 40 years with a video. Now, this will require a little bit of explanation for those of you who aren't from the UK. So not far from here, we have Nelson's Column, which is in Trafalgar Square, which celebrates Britain's victory at the Battle of Trafalgar. We also have this very famous TV programme in the UK called Blue Peter, where presenters are challenged to do difficult things. In 1975, a guy called John Noakes, the chap on the right-hand side here, was challenged to climb up Nelson's Column. 40 years later, Connie Hugg, on the left-hand side, also climbed up Nelson's Column. This is what it looked like.
Well, I'm hard hatted up and ready to go. It took 3 weeks to put this scaffolding up, and under it lies one of London's best known landmarks. It's 250 steps up to the top, so I've got a way to go.
It's a long way, isn't it?
It is, yeah.
How high is it?
Oh, it's about 180 feet, I think.
Is it? How are the ladders fixed on it?
They're
quite firmly.
They're roped quite firmly around the actual column itself.
Yeah.
And they're very secure, like, you know?
It's a bit where he ties a rope on. I just love that. So if you ask me to climb up Nelson's Column, I think I'd rather do it on the scaffolding. But I might not be able to wait 3 weeks for it to be erected. So all of us here know that air power matters. I think all of us also have seen over the last day and a half that air power matters more now than it has done for a long time. The threats we are facing and the challenges that we have to overcome are also changing. What we have to do is work together and develop our thinking that will ensure our adversaries know that we're ready to fly and fight and that they'll lose. And I'm really looking forward to working together with you for more than 2 years on developing that. Thanks very much. Thanks.
Sir Rich, really, really fascinating.